right, let's all get our handle this evening. Stand and sing, page number 45. Would you be free from your burden of sin? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Would your evil a victory win? There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, wonder-working power in the blood of the Lamb. All right, on the last verse. Would you do service for Jesus, your King? There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Would you live daily His praises to sing? There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, power, wonder-working power in the blood.
December starts Tuesday, so we need to think about if we're going to Christmas caroling. So if you're interested and want to, we need to have a little chit-chat about that real soon as to when and whatever we're going to do there. I'm game if y'all game, so think about it, and we need to talk about a date and stuff like that. Y'all want to, we'll chatter on that just as at the end of the service. And then whether or not we'll do a Christmas dinner or whatever, we didn't do one for Thanksgiving. So y'all think about those things, and we'll discuss it in a little bit. Amen.
Sometimes I feel no one's ever been in this place before. This is hard, and I'm not sure that I can do this anymore. I know someday I'll look back, and all this won't seem real. But Lord, right now I need You to know just how I feel.
When there are no words to say, and no prayer that I can pray, hear my heart. When I don't have strength to try, and I've cried all I can cry, hear my heart.
you know every fear and every doubt I cannot speak.
You know all the ways I need you and all the ways I'm weak, so I'll be quiet
so you can hear my heart. Every now and then I recall a simple phrase or melody. Comforts and it quiets, picks me up and then it carries me far above the pain and hurt I thought would never end. The song speaks words I cannot, calms the fears within.
When there are no words to say and a prayer that I can pray, hear my heart. When I don't have strength to try and I've cried all I can cry, hear my heart.
'Cause you know every fear and every doubt I cannot speak.
You know all the ways I need you and all the ways I'm weak, so I'll be quiet
so you can hear my heart.
Lord, I'll be quiet
so you can hear my heart. So you can hear my heart.
They ask, oh Lazarus, can you explain how a man could be dead and then live again? Oh, that's just insane. But old Lazarus said, boy, I heard a voice. He spoke right to me. Death set me free when he called my name. He called my name, and I heard a voice. He called my name, and I made my choice. I knew that my life would never be the same after he called.
After he called,
he called my name. They asked Zacchaeus,
Can you tell us about Jesus in a sycamore tree? He said I climbed up to see the Savior walk past, but the Savior called out, tonight I'll stay at your house. So I let him in, and he forgave me of my sin, and he called my name. He called my name, and I heard a voice. He called my name, and I made my choice. I knew that my life would never be the same after he called.
After he called.
He called my name. Thank God he called.
Thank God he called.
He called my name. He called my name.
Amen. All right, take your Bibles this evening and turn with me to the book of Matthew, Matthew chapter 2. Pray much about the Jubilee this week. Brother Joe will be with us on Wednesday night, and Jonathan and Miss Amy and them will be here singing to help out in that on Wednesday night. And then Thursday and Friday night, Brother Jeremy Simpson's going to be with us. So thank the Lord for that. Amen. And we'll be excited about that, and I'm sure they'll be to sing with us as well. You folks have some songs ready in case we Lord leads in that direction. That's what we'll do. Amen. But come for Jubilee. Come prayed up. Invite some folks. I know folks are COVID scared. Tell them to wear a mask or sit by themselves, whatever they choose to do. And come go to church with us a little bit. Amen. And there's plenty of room in here to stretch out, leave room between each other. There's a couple places where you can leave an empty pew or so between you, so you'll be safer here than you will in a lot of places that you travel to, in and out of the gas stations, in and out of grocery stores, that God-forsaken place called Walmart. I was talking to a boy yesterday. I said, I don't think I've even been in there this year. I hope I can keep my record up. Amen. I'm telling you, I just don't like going in there. But anyway, going to Matthew chapter 2 with us this evening. Matthew chapter 2. Remember the Dorothy Reap family. She passed away this morning. The tax lady, Miss Dorothy Reap, that was there on Center Street. Across from, well, not quite across from Hardy's, but right there at Hardy's. She passed away this morning, sort of unexpected. She has had some illness over the last year or so. You know, she's in the hospital for several months there at one time and thought they was doing well, and according to Miss Joy, things changed in a hurry. So much prayer for them, for her daughter Miss Joy Shuford. The Lord would help those folks in these days, so much prayer there. And remember our other folk, remember, be praying for baby Noah, Miss Ella, Kelly and David as they deal with these situations there. Remember Miss Nikki, I think she's got an appointment tomorrow with a doctor. Who else? Somebody else has got one this week. I've got one Wednesday with the allergy specialist, so pray we can get a little bit of a handle on that mess. Bills not to February. Yes, ma'am. All right. Remember Miss Ann, she's got one Tuesday. Oh, was it in there today? Okay.
Well, she posted this morning like it happened this morning, so that's why I thought that. Remember, the Adkins family lost a loved one. Yes, sir. Yeah, pray for Scott. He gets doctor results tomorrow. So if a doctor don't get him, a wife will. So you pray for him. And he's probably going to go on half rationings. He probably set that result day up. I don't know if y'all know that he's that smart. But if he'd have got the results before Thanksgiving, he'd have probably got cut back on his meals. So anyway, he gets results in the morning. Throw him under the bus. Pray all that goes well for him. And then by him Thursday or Wednesday with the allergy specialist. I don't know whether they're going to do all that testing Wednesday or not. Supposed to, because they've told me what I can't do, take in over the next few days. So hopefully they can find out a little bit about what's causing my allergies. And hopefully I can either get some kind of a shot or something to help me with it, because it's really aggravating, and especially with stuff that I like, it bothers even that, and it's amazing that it bothers you like that. But odors is the big thing, different odors. Somebody had on some good smelling stuff this morning. I don't know whether it was their downies or dryer sheets or whatever, but it smelled good. But boy, it was starting to get to me, so I have to be careful with some of those things. But hopefully we can get a conclusion on that and a resolution to fix that. So pray that works out for me Wednesday. Amen. So Tuesday, Nikki, I think it's tomorrow, and then the next week I believe is baby Ella's. I think hers is, huh? It's this week too. So what's hers? Thursday, Friday? Okay. All right. That'd be Thursday then. Okay. Good. I was hoping they could get her on in there. So pray about that. She's got some situation going on there that she needs much prayer, Miss Kelly, as well. I know it'll wear you to pieces when your baby's is not doing well. Little Clay's got to have a procedure or a surgery. Real soon, they're trying to get that scheduled up. He had a little, I don't know how to describe it really. It's something in the form of a hernia kind of thing, but it's not. But they've got to remove a little fluid packet from him. So pray about that. I know it's very concerning to the mom and the daddy when they go to work on your baby, a literal baby. So, but they was, he went Friday to get checked out and see what was going on because he had that a bump. And they checked him out, and the nurse told Matthew and them, said, "Now listen, I promise we're not going to kill him. He's going to scream like we're killing him when we do this, like a sonogram kind of thing. When we do this, he's going to scream like we're killing him, but I promise we're not hurting him. We're not going to do anything to hurt him. We'll take great care of him." And he just sat there and smiled at him while he done it. So they was very set back with that. They wasn't ready for him to be that calm and cool, and he did great. Through the whole testing and everything that they did, he did great. So, but he is going to have a surgery, which they'll have to put him to sleep, and they don't like doing that with babies, but it's got to be done. So pray for that situation there. They're supposed to be getting notified of when they can do it and who's going to do it. They're hoping to be able to go back to the one that done his early surgery there a year ago. So pray that works out. All right. Anything else we need to mention? Yes, ma'am. All right. Remember that family. Pray much about that. Okay. All right. Pray about that. Yes, ma'am. The baby had been over there. Well, that's a week ago, though, wasn't it? So, yeah, they're a week out on that one. You don't know? You don't know? Everybody stay away from Judy. You stay upstairs, I'll stay downstairs. We're good. Pray about it. It's going around, and it's nothing new. We've been around all this before, so just pray the Lord will help and keep everybody healthy. I'd like to see this thing up and gone. Amen. So much prayer needed there. She's describing folks connected to the family, but none in the family itself has been sick with anything. So just remember to pray for all those folks that has been infected, that it'll go easy and fast. Brother Brady Rochester, his wife, Miss Angel, had it and had a little bit of it. Wasn't super bad. And nobody else in the whole family got it, as much as they was around each other and traveling in the bus together. So it's different. It's a different varmint. Some people get it and some people don't. So you just don't know. Being exposed doesn't mean necessarily that you're going to get it. And then if you do get it, it doesn't necessarily mean you're going to have it really bad. So pray about that. Amen? Amen. All right. Matthew chapter 2 this evening. Now, when Jesus was born in the Bethlehem of Judea, in the days of Herod the king, behold, there was wise men from the east. There came wise men from the east to Jerusalem, saying, "Where is he that is born King of the Jews? For we have seen his star in the east and are come to worship him." When Herod the king had heard these things, he was troubled, and all Jerusalem with him. And when he had gathered all the chief priests and the scribes of the people together, he demanded of them where Christ should be born. And they said unto him, "In Bethlehem of Judea, for thus it is written by the prophets, and thou, Bethlehem, in the land of Judah, art not the least among the princes of Judah, for out of thee shall come a governor that shall rule my people." Then Herod, when he had privately called the wise men, inquired of them diligently what time the star appeared. And he sent them to Bethlehem and said, "Go and search diligently for the young child, and when ye have found him, bring me word again, that I may come and worship him also." There's the words of a lying politician. Amen. And when they had heard the king, they departed, and lo, the star which they saw in the east went before them, till it came and stood over where the young child was. When they saw the star, they rejoiced with exceeding great joy. And when they were come into the house, they saw the young child with Mary his mother, and fell down and worshipped him. And when they had opened their treasures, they presented unto him gifts, gold and frankincense and myrrh. And being warned of God in a dream that they should not return to Herod, they departed to their own country another way. Let's pray. Father, I pray that you'd help us tonight as we look into thy word. Lord, very familiar passage to us, so I pray that you'd help us, Lord, to look at it and to get what you would have for us out of this that would help us, encourage us, strengthen us, make us better Christians. Then, Lord, we pray for the sick, these many that's been mentioned tonight, those folks that's got COVID, others that's been being tested. Lord, we pray that you'd have your will, have your way in that. Give them strength and healing for those that are infected. And Lord, I pray again, please help this thing to go away, that we might get back to normal living. And we'll thank you for what you do. Bless us again. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. I want to deal just a little bit tonight with this matter of the gift and talk about it a little bit. I know that through the years we preach on these things and we look at these different sermons in the area of Jesus Christ, the Son, being born in the Christmas season. It's the time that we have set aside to honor the birth of Lord Jesus Christ. Not sure that this is the exact timing in which he was born there, But it is the day that was set aside many, many years ago to honor and worship the birth of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. So we follow with that and do the best we can to give him the honor and praise in these days. Now, a couple things I want to point out to us. One, I want you to notice that these wise men that came from the east, they came to the calling of the light, the star that hung in the sky that identified where they needed to go and gave them direction for which they should follow. Remember that Jesus, when walking among man, told them that he was the light of the world. St. John chapter 1 verse 9 says, speaking of John the Baptist, that he was not that light, that was the true light, which lighteth every man that cometh into the world. John 8:12 said, then Jesus spake unto them, saying, I am the light of the world. He that followeth me shall not walk in darkness, but shall have the light of life. And then again in John 9:5 says, as long as I am in the world, I am the light of the world. So the light, a lot of folks relate the light, the star that was shining there brightly for the wise men to follow, is a direct reflection of the Lord Jesus Christ himself. And given the light, or a type showing that Jesus is the light of the world, even in the darkness of the night, they had light. So remember that, even as dark as things can get, we still have Jesus Christ, which will give us the light that will direct us in the way that we should go. So have no fear, regardless of how things goes, how things gets rough. We're going to go through some troubled times, we know that. And in that, we know that we have Jesus Christ, the light of the world, to give us light as we go through that. Remember when Jesus hung there on Calvary, that God the Father turned all the lights out throughout the whole world. The sun went dark. The sun went black. The sun showed no light. God turned the lights out for 3 hours across the world while Jesus himself hung on Calvary. And the light of the world, that's what he had prophesied, that's what he told them as he preached through the years, that he was the light of the world there. As I read in John 1:9, St. John 8:12, and St. John 9:5, those three verses through the ministry of the Lord, he told them he was the light of the world. He's hanging on Calvary and the light goes out. Don't you think that was a reminder to those that he had preached the messages to, that I am the light of the world? It proved that he was the light of the world as he hung there on Calvary. But these wise men were following the light. They were led by the light of God. No man had control over that light, to turn it on or to turn it off. No man had control of that. Only God himself could turn that light on or off. So it's wonderful how God gave them the light. Now, I would like to read, as Paul Harvey said, the rest of the story. How'd they know this light was coming? How'd they know they were to follow this light to worship him? What's the rest of the story on that? Because I want to remind you, and I know I won't mention it several times, these wise men weren't Jews. They haven't been reared up listening to the prophecy of Isaiah and Jeremiah and hearing the stories of old and reading the accounts of Exodus and all these things. These wise men were Gentile men. So that brings in a lot. So you see the calling of the light of these guys that brought them in there, and then the coming of, they saw the light and they followed it. The coming to the light, or following the light, these Gentile leaders, because of the light that drew them to the place of worshiping Jesus, King of the Jews. Now he identifies him as king in this passage. These wise men already are coming to worship him as king. Now man, that's something to think about. Get a hold of this. They're coming to worship a baby lying in a manger. They're coming to worship this baby in the house of his mother. But yet they're worshiping him as the king of the Jews. That's what it says. Worship him, king of the Jews. So these wise men, these men are following the light that God gave them to come and to give worship to him as Gentiles. And, you know, when you think about how the Gentiles were drew to worship the Lord and how that the Jews withdrew from worshiping the Lord. And there's many verses that goes with that, but Luke 17:25, Jesus talking to the disciples says, but first must he suffer many things and be rejected of this generation. St. John 1:11 says he came to his own and his own received him not. And it's amazing how that the Gentiles were first to worship Jesus rather than the Jews, his own people. And that's something to get a hold of. See, when you go to studying this about the Lord and how that he came not just for the Jews, his name Jesus, for he shall save his people. I really don't think that's just limited to the Jews, because I'm his people now. Amen. Because I got saved by the grace of God. I called on him by faith. I acknowledged him as Lord and Savior, me a sinner. When I asked him to forgive me of my sins, he did. Now I'm part of the family of God, and he came to save his own. So, I mean, that could be broadened out to not just speaking of the Jews. Because he did save the Jews, but he saved the Gentiles. He brought the message to the Gentiles. You know, for years we've been taught about Paul, the Apostle Paul, and how that Paul carried the message to the Gentiles. The other disciples, most of those, preached to the Jews, particularly Simon Peter. You know, Simon Peter was all about preaching to the Jews and was very condemning, bad-spirited towards the Gentiles. Remember in John 4 there, the disciple says, we're not going through Samaria. We're going around it. We'll go to the city around it. We're not going through Samaria because it was Gentiles. And they spoke harshly, very racist, if you will, of the Gentiles, which means anybody that wasn't a Jew. Anybody, no matter what country, if you ain't Jew, you're Gentile. So you understand these Gentiles were the first to worship. These leaders and Gentiles, these wise men, prominent men, came to Jesus for the purpose of worshiping him. That's proven because they would bring in gifts. And I'm talking about that gift. I'm going to get there in just a second. The coming of the leaders, they came to him. The contrast here again is the Gentiles worshiping the Jewish king. And you're going to see that. Jesus said that all nations, all knees shall bow, and the nations shall come and bow before him. They're going to recognize him as Lord and Savior. One day they are going to recognize him as King of Kings one day. It's coming, and it ain't far away. Me and Brother Jeremy's talking today about it, and it's not far away. I don't think we've got a lot longer to go in this world. I really don't. I don't think Christians has a lot longer in the world. It's not just a select few. I don't think that it's going to be long until the Lord calls the church out. These things is going to get worse and worse as we go. But the contrast, as already mentioned, these leaders were Gentiles. Luke chapter 2, verse 32 says, a light to lighten the Gentiles and the glory of thy people Israel. So there's that contrast of those leaders. Isaiah chapter 11, verse 10 says, and in that day there shall be a root of Jesse, which shall stand for the ensign of the people. To it shall the Gentiles seek, and his rest shall be glorious. So the Gentiles will seek. Well, here's fulfillment of that prophecy. Here's the wise men that come to see Jesus by following the light. Now, I want to look at this gift just a little bit tonight, the gift for God or the gift for Jesus. I want us to look at that and think about it just briefly tonight. I want you to think about the gift. I know that we've discussed it in times past. We've talked about the gold, the frankincense, and the myrrh. The gold is that gift that's designated for a king. If you go through the history and study the kings, they oftentimes brought gold to the kings as a worthy gift for a king. Frankincense speaks of his divinity, that the odor, the sweet smelling odor, the good stuff there is speaking of the divinity, the Lord Jesus Christ. And then the myrrh speaks of his humanity, because the myrrh is for a special purpose of anointing those that were injured or dying. Remember, that's what that alabaster box was that Mary broke and anointed the Lord with for his burial, to make him smell good even though he was going to the grave. They didn't embalm as we do today. They didn't carry out all of those things as what we've got today, to the best of my knowledge. So they put the frankincense and the myrrh, they put that on the body to give it a good sweet odor. And remember, after that occasion of Mary, before he was crucified, they come back to the tomb again to apply more. So they wanted to make sure that he didn't have the awful odor that goes with the death of a body. So, but as I was saying, let me before I forget this, as those kings or these wise men came to worship the Lord Jesus as king, a babe lying in the manger, there shows their exercising of faith. He's a baby. He's not old enough yet for them to anoint as the king. He's still a baby, but their faith is that God's going to fulfill that, what's been prophesied through the years. So there was some exercising of faith there. When you think about the cost of these gifts, now one thing to think about in a gift, in considering the cost, I'm going to use the same point twice. One, in considering the cost of it, you consider who it's from. And when you consider who it's from, this will define truly how much it costs them. A costly gift of $100 to me may not be that much of a cost to someone that has more money. You have a, let's use crazy numbers. Let's say I've got a net worth of $100,000 with my house and all the things together. I'm worth $100,000, everything I've got put in the bag. And a gentleman that's worth $1 million, everything he's got put in the bag, the gift of $100 is a lot more for me to give than it is for the guy that's got $1 million. Y'all following me? So when you consider who it's from, that brings about the cost of a gift. That relates to us, because what we're giving to God, you know, if we was to say, monetarily speaking, we was taking up a money offering for the Lord, and we used to take up an offering and we're all going to give a gift. Well, if I throw in a $10 bill and I got several hundreds laying beside it, I really ain't gave a sacrificial gift. But for somebody that ain't got but $100 in their billfold, if they got that, most of you ain't got them a cards. But if you got $100 in your billfold and you give a 10 of it, that's a little more giving. You following me? Because you consider who it's from, what they have. When you consider the woman that had two mites and she throwed that two mites in there, she reached in her pocket and found two mites. We consider that to be like pennies. And she grabs them two together and she takes and drops them in the offering pan. Her two mites was as much as if some people would have gave $1 million. The reason behind that is because she gave of all that she had. She didn't have nothing left in her pocket. When she pulled the pocket out, it's empty. She didn't have nothing else in there. She didn't have no more to give. So she gave of her all, as the Lord said. And God took such account to it, he said, hey, I want this preached as a memorial to her forevermore. Amen. Where the gospel's preached, he wants it preached about this woman that gave her two mites. So I'm fulfilling the commandment of God by mentioning her. Amen. That's what Jesus said to do. We're doing it. Amen. So when you consider who it's from, the cost matters. When you consider who it's from, that puts the value to the gift. Somebody walks up and gives you a normal gift that you don't know them from Adam's house cats. You've never met them. You don't know nothing about their background or what they've got or anything like that. And they hand you a gift and it's a gift. But if one of my grandkids walks in with a simple little old bitty gift and hand it to me, that's a gift. Y'all follow where I'm coming from on considering who it's from? not just about what they have valuable speaking, but consider who it is that's given the gift. I've got some pictures drawn that's on my wall back there in my office that's worth a lot to me because Christopher drawed them for me personally. He didn't draw them for you. He drawed them for me. That deer on that wall in there behind my desk, Chris drawed that just for me. That puts more value to that than somebody else that just throwed it out there. You follow me? So when you consider the giver, that makes it more valuable to the receiver. You know, we've had through years of vacation Bible school, the kids will sometimes put together a craft and they'll make it up for mama or dad or for grandma or grandpa, and they'll give that. And you might have two or three popsicle sticks glued together with a little coloring on them. Reality, that's not a very valuable gift. But when you consider who it's from, you can't put a price on it. There's no way to put a value to that because they was thinking of you. They was respecting and loving you as they put the gift together to give it to you. Talking about the cost of the gift. Consider who it's from. Their values versus what they're given. Consider who it's from in that they put it together and gave it. Amen? So it's a little when you consider this cost of the gift. One of the commentaries I was reading, pulpit commentary, says this, of speaking of the gift, says they consecrate their substance, the gold, etc. Some will give to Christ personal service but withhold property. Others will give property but withhold personal service. The My Guy, which is speaking of these guys, gave both. And Christ is worthy of all. Not only did they give of property, but they gave personally. And I'm going to deal with that here in just a minute. But you think about the personalness that goes in with the gift. And with that, I'm thinking about the care of the gift. Not the cost, but the care. Let's think about the care of the gift for a minute tonight. Verse number 11 there, he's talking about they came and fell down before him and worshiped him, and they opened their treasures. They presented unto him gifts. So when you think about the care of the gift, one, they cared for it personally. This gift that they brought to the Lord Jesus Christ is one that they cared for personally. No one was entrusted to bring this gift to Christ for them. And this is a major part of the experience of the gift. Because what we do a lot of times, we give specific gifts for an emotional reaction. We're looking for a great big smile or a touched heart when we present or give gifts. And here, that's what they're doing here. The care of this gift, they didn't say, hey guys, load the caravan up, you guys take that gift over and find Jesus and give that gift to Jesus for me, will you? No, in this incident here, they personally brought that gift. They cared for this gift personally. In that, they treasured them. They it says here that they opened their treasure. So this is something they treasured. I imagine they was very careful with it on their journey. They wanted to make sure it didn't get broke, damaged, or injured in any way as they bring their treasures to the Lord. So they cared for it personally. They was looking for the emotional or the spiritual attachment there. Now, they're bringing it to a baby. We know that. A baby's probably not going to give a whole lot of an emotional response in this right now. But you consider the baby they're bringing it to, and the Lord Jesus Christ, he's going to know for sure who all this is about in just a few days. Because he's going to grow up, and he's going to know that these three, I mean, it's in our Bible. We're reading about it today, ain't we? So Jesus knows these wise men brought these gifts that they personally cared for. And they carried it to him personally. The importance of this gift is they brought it to them. You know, Dad used to be much about giving you money for Christmas or whatever. He'd give you money and say, go get what you want. I finally told him one day, I said, Dad, just be honest with you, I don't want the money. I'd rather you go find something that you want me to have and give it to me that way than just to give me the money. My wife's sitting back there. She's the same fashion. For me just to hand her money, that's just handing money. That giving of your time and your talent and your effort and finding something that you know that will be pleasing them and then giving it to them, that's different. That adds a little bit of something to that, amen? So there's a personal care, and it was carried to them personally. They personally, the ones that laid this at the feet of Jesus. They didn't entrust someone. Now, you know these guys has got gold, frankincense, and myrrh. They got money. They could have paid somebody to carry this over there and lay it at the feet of Jesus, or lay it in the manger there next to Jesus, and the gift would have been the same, wouldn't it? But the difference in it is they made it personal. The care of the gift, they was personal with this gift. Something to think about. The personal part of a gift is what makes them more precious. I've got things that Dad gave me. I've got things Judy's gave me. I've got things the kids have given me. I've got things the church has given me. I can go replace them with a monetary amount of finances, but I can't replace the personalness of that gift that they gave. It ain't the same. Seiko probably put out thousands of these watches. It's a Seiko Kinetic watch. They probably put out thousands of them. You can go buy nothing. You can't buy this one. You following me? That gift was given to me by a very precious person. That gift was wore by a very precious person. That's Brother Harold's watch. Very precious to me. The monetary value that it would take to replace that just in the item itself won't touch what it means to my heart. You follow me? Talking about the gift. See, there's more in the gift than just gold, frankincense, and myrrh. There's the personalness that goes with it, if that's even a word. I don't know if that's even a word, but it worked. But the personal touch, the personal care, the personal heart that's involved in this gift that these men each gave. So there's the cost of the gift, the care of the gift. And then there's the committing of it. When you look at this gift here, it says they opened their treasure and they presented unto him the gifts. As I said, the giving of it, he could have hired some folks to carry that gift and give it. But each man chose personally to bring that gift and give it to Jesus. And that's what means something with it. Here's where they personally were involved in the giving of the gift. Now, you think about this season. It's a time for giving. We give to each other. We show each other that we care and we love each other by giving gifts to each other. May not be a great, large monetary value as far as what it cost you to give that gift, but the personalness of that gift makes it great. Now, the Lord himself orchestrated getting this King James Bible put together. And he's preserved it that we can today, tonight, as we're here in church, read about how these wise men brought gold, frankincense, and myrrh, and they gave it to him. He wanted us to realize how precious this matter of giving really is. We talk about Christmas, we talk about the gift of giving, and we talk about the giving of the Lord to others by tract, testimony,
however, whatever means you use to get the word of God out to others and let others know about the precious gift that God gave us. And it is a season of giving. Let's put him on the front end of our giving. Let's make sure the Lord and Savior Jesus Christ is the one that we give the most to. Not just a specific monetary amount, but that we give of ourselves unto him. As I said, this gold, frankincense, and myrrh could have been brought by anybody else. But when we add the personal touch to it, when we show that we personally care, it really makes a difference. So let's give unto the Lord as these kings did. I can't bring a brick of gold. Frankincense and myrrh, you know, these things that we bring. But I can personally commit myself. It says they presented it. I can personally commit myself unto him. And when I do that, all that I got is his. Now, we're supposed to have done that and we got saved. Some folks don't do that. Some folks do that later in life. They'll make a full surrender later on. They'll commit their life to the Lord. But we ought to be fully committed to the Lord with everything we've got and say, here am I, Lord, I give you the best I've got to offer is me, because that involves everything about me. What I've got is yours. Talents, tithes, treasures, whatever I've got, all that I have is yours, Lord. And that's what God wants from us, is just us. He wants us to commit ourselves to him, to present ourselves to him, to humble ourselves to him and say, here, my Lord, use me. Like Isaiah said in Isaiah 6, here, my Lord, send me, or Isaiah 1, here, my Lord, send me. Here am I. Send me. God's got work for us to do, many to do. And in that, we commit ourselves. Here am I. Send me. Let's pray. Father, pray you'll take the thoughts tonight, use them for your glory. Help us, Lord. I know that I just sort of presented a good little old thought here tonight, but